Imagine if you are a member of an alien civilization. Looking around you, you might see things that an Earthling might find very strange. Trees with black leaves, a red dwarf sun in the sky, and a planet that exists in one half perpetual darkness and in another constant punishing light. You might live in the twilight, the area of this world that sees some mix of light and dark, but cannot exist in the whole of it. Imagine a much bigger Antarctica and much bigger deserts. Imagine you are a very old alien civilization on this world, perhaps a billion years old since the advent of your technological empire, that you once only barely achieved because of the harsh conditions of your world. Maybe the only clues you have to your biological origins are vague archaeological examinations of the geologic record, assuming your planet still has one. All else is lost to the immense time your civilization has existed. Data can be destroyed, calamities can happen, and those might have left you with less of an understanding of your origins than we humans have, ourselves being much closer in time to our own origins. As anatomically modern humans, it's only been a few hundred thousand years, but the beginning of our technological civilization, far less. But that may change. And in only a few centuries, we ourselves may no longer be in our original biological form, but rather something else, something new. Aliens aren't beholden to their biology either, and with a command of genetics and advanced computation, may have left their biological forms completely, and no one member of that civilization can recall the times of non-synthetic biology. Imagine that alien world again. Even the formerly natural animals and plants of your world have become technological mirrors of their former selves, uplifted at some point by some previous iteration of your past society. Perhaps everything alive on your world is intelligent, made that way out of some cultural obligation to uplift all species, or perhaps selective intelligence, giving only what is needed to meet your end goal. A plant that can deploy its own grow lights when needed would be a useful plant indeed. If you were in this position as a super civilization, you might know what the great filters truly are that create the great silence that you yourself still see after all these millennia. Say, in all your years, you have never seen another instance of alien life. Would you continue to look? Would you deem it worthwhile to send out messages of your own after having tried that? Long term, only to hear nothing in return? Would you start at some point to simply ignore the universe once you had a full understanding of it and turn inward and never notice other civilizations popping up around you? That is the first part of the time problem within SETI. We don't know what time scales alien civilizations operate on. Do they last immeasurable amounts of time, hanging on indefinitely until whatever end the universe meets that prevents them from going on any longer? Or do they last very short periods of time, snuffed out by their own technology, a risk we run? If this is the case, then it very well may be that the reason we don't see alien civilizations is that they are all flashes in the pan, and the odds of us just happening to exist right now in a position to see another civilization are just too terrible to ever expect to see anyone. You could call this solution to the Fermi Paradox the ships passing in the night scenario, where a galaxy like the Milky Way may produce hundreds or even thousands or possibly millions of civilizations over its effective lifetime of trillions of years. But the chances of any two existing at the same time are exceedingly low. If the average duration of a technological civilization is, say, 10,000 years, then it's unlikely anyone is going to see anyone else. If the average period a civilization remains technological is much shorter, say 300 years, then it becomes almost impossible. This would be a sad universe indeed, where almost all alien civilizations look out into the cold and the dark and see only nature, but never a companion civilization. Perhaps in some distant galaxy there might be contact, a rare and precious thing where the luck of the odds just happened to be in favor of a pair of civilizations coming into contact. But for most, it's only silence and the uncertainty that the profound quiet must mean that no one ever makes it past a coming great filter. We would then truly live in a universe where all signs of life are necrosignatures of extinct species. This problem gets even worse if intelligent life is exceedingly rare in its own right and almost never happens. Rare intelligent life coupled with rare technological survival could provide perhaps the simplest resolution to the Fermi paradox. But it might also be paradoxical in its own right, because no two civilizations are likely to be culturally and developmentally similar. Perhaps there are worlds out there that, by their nature, never had conflicts and warfare, managed their resources wisely, and simply do not suffer from our all-too-human problems. Maybe it's possible to last a billion years. That said, there could be worse, very advanced aliens that reach levels of technology that go very wrong in ways we can only just barely imagine. A good one would be opening up a wormhole only to have an anti-star accidentally come through and annihilate your sun in one fell swoop of matter-antimatter reaction. Not good. But such a thing would be a great filter that for us, if it's even possible, lies thousands of years in our future and is not currently on our list of potential extinction events. The unenvisioned extinction event. Another aspect of the time problem within SETI is that we haven't the slightest idea of what time scales aliens work on. This is compounded by the problem that we don't know what time scales we will work on in 100 years. Right now, it's straightforward. We work on minutes, hours, years, and so on. But imagine if the average human lifespan were 10,000 years. In that case, a year would indeed be a very small amount of time. And it has to be said, we may alter our perception of time in the future. And there's the issue of cost versus benefit in detecting alien civilizations. It may simply be that contact of any type is materially expensive. If you detect someone out there, you'll need to put significant energy into a signal to them that they're likely to pick up. Say it's a directed radio signal beamed specifically at their planet. Say they were a mere 20 light years away. It would require significant resources to do it unambiguously. But you probably wouldn't choose to do this unless you knew for certain that there was someone there. For all you know, shots in the dark are a waste. And that holds true for us. Rarely do we shoot out signals to other worlds, and then we don't usually repeat them. So maybe efficiency is key to alien first contact. In a paper by Omri Wandel, link in the description below, he details a solution to the Fermi paradox where we simply haven't existed as a technological civilization long enough to be noticed. He proposes the concept of a contact era, where after thousands of years of existence as a broadcasting civilization, we finally get noticed, and someone beams a signal to us, but not earlier than that. Part of this idea is that biology may be very, very common in the universe. It may be that the advent of microbial life is simply the end result of a specific process in organic chemistry. That's backed up by some recent findings in the field of figuring out abiogenesis. We don't know the entire process yet, the details elude us, but things like the generation of RNA have turned out to be way easier than we envisioned. Indeed, one of the reasons we didn't see these before is simply because we were looking for something more complicated than what actually happens. If that holds true for all of abiogenesis, a nut we will very probably crack within the next few decades, then microbial life is indeed common in the universe. In fact, it may be pervaded with it. If that's the case and biospheres are common, then you have to ask the question of whether the great filter is really just that intelligent life is uncommon. After all, Earth took 4.6 billion years to reach us, and we're a fairly recent development. That may mean that for alien civilizations, planets with biospheres are to be expected, but the vast majority of them have no intelligent life. Could it be that simple life, or even life on the level of the dinosaurs, is so common that it's not really of interest to an ancient alien civilization? Rather, they only focus on an exoplanet when they see that it has a technosignature. If that's the case, no one beyond a radius of 100 light years likely knows about us. That's a drop in the bucket for a galaxy 100,000 light years in diameter. In short, it may be that no one is close enough to know that we've become interesting. They might watch this world because they detected biosignature gases, but it's simply sitting on some waiting list, where some alien astronomer checks in every 50, 200, or 2,000 years, and ultimately detects us in their sampling and sends out a repeating contact message that we can't miss. But they don't yet have a reason to do that, since we're only just barely at our advent of detectable technological civilization, and we must now wait for our signal, such as it is, to propagate. Perhaps we as humans are simply impatient in our expectation to see alien radio signals. Perhaps, as the author suggests, the problem is that we have a very small radiosphere. Almost no one is close enough to pick us up. and someday the galaxy may begin to light up for us with directed radio signals. And it's worth noting they may not beam a radio signal to us at all. Rather, they might send a probe that needs to cross space-time at sub-relativistic speeds to get here, adding even more time to the first contact equation. And there's actually a statistical basis for this. The closer an alien detection is to you, the less likely it is, at least if you look at it in a certain way. If you see an alien civilization in the closest star system to you, say Alpha Centauri, then an alien presence throughout the galaxy is implied. If you see them that close, they must be everywhere. Well, why? Do they really need to be everywhere? There is a lot of real estate in the galaxy, and we're sort of in a backwater on a number of counts. This may not be the ideal place to position a probe, only that it becomes an interesting place to station a probe once you know a civilization exists here, which almost no one yet knows. And then there is the ultimate time problem, the distance between the galaxies. If a galaxy hosts only one active civilization at any given time, you might look to other galaxies for proof of the existence of alien life. But the further you get out, as far as galaxies go, you get to a point, and this goes for the vast majority of galaxies, where you see the galaxy so far in the past that there was simply not enough time from the Big Bang for life to arise in them and be visible on a galactic scale from your perspective. Point is, time is somewhat of an understated problem in SETI. But not just intergalactically, but within the Milky Way itself. Even artifact SETI suffers from a time problem. If aliens in the past had ever passed through and visited Earth, say they landed and stayed a few months 100 million years ago, the chances of any evidence surviving on Earth is basically zero. The planet simply weathers and subducts evidence, and things survive in the geologic record purely by chance. Something so specific as a few pieces of alien equipment left behind is highly unlikely on this world. Such a thing surviving on the moon, however, stands a much better chance. Who knows what we might find as we explore the solar system, but I think it would be sad if we found something of alien origin, but then go on to never answer the question as to if they are still around somewhere out there in the vastness of space and time. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned about aliens uplifting their plant life to intelligence. Imagine if we did that. That's a great filter right there. Revenge of the carrots, and Earth becomes an intelligent carrot world until they make the mistake of uplifting the onions, and it's nothing but great filters from then on. Very unsettling, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.